slip my memory. I could asking, Lord,
to remember me.
As my
Savior,
you take him to. Won't you take him to? I took Jesus as my Savior.
You take him to.
While my friend,
while
his spirit is calling you. Listen, I've got a home in glory land that
outshines the sun.
Got a mansion, got a mansion, way in glory.
Outshines the sun,
yeah.
way beyond the blue.
I've got peace
like a river.
I've got peace just like a river. I've got
peace like a river in my soul.
My
love like an ocean.
Good morning. Good to see you here today. Want to just remind you about Sunday school next week. We are going to, some of the classes have already been going on, but we're going to try to get started back more next week. And we're going to start at 10 o'clock instead of 9:45. So just remember that day, that time. Classes will need to continue social distancing in the classroom. We have made every effort to provide for individuals to be safe in the classroom, but it's still up to each individual to help contain the spread of the virus. Hand sanitizer and mask will be available in the classroom. Temperature checks that are done prior to Sunday school do not need to be redone for the worship service. Two classes that are moving to a different location are the preschool kindergarten class in the Family Life Center, and the middle school class will move to the second floor of the education building across from the New Directions classroom. We'll not have a nursery at this time. Parents are asked to keep their nursery age little ones with them. The senior adults men's class will join with the Jennings Brooks class that is currently meeting in the gym for the next few weeks. If you're not comfortable returning to Sunday school at this time, then please know it's fine to study your lesson at home. Teachers will be glad to see that you are provided with the literature at home. If you have any questions, you can check with Wanda and she'll be glad to fill you in. I want to welcome any visitors today. I don't see any, but if we do have any, we're glad to have you. We'll have a business meeting next Sunday morning before the worship service. Marshall Lockridge, I understand, is doing better, so let's continue to pray for him. And if we have others in our church that I may not be aware of, let's just remember them, not only for the coronavirus, but for whatever. Speaking of that, Sam Miles is having some surgery this Thursday, so let's remember him. Marilyn Hester is in the hospital. Okay, all right, then let's remember them. I talked to Cindy this week one day, and she said that she was mainly just staying in bed and sleeping a lot, so let's remember them. Mary Beth and her family, they're still having, her mother's still having her aging problems. As 95 and a half, she's done well. Let's see, I thought I had one more list. Oh, her sister in Texas, they're all recovering. They all three wound up having the coronavirus, but they're much better now. Last thing, I think we need to especially pray for our country. You never thought you'd see the things that we saw this week, regardless of what political spectrum you're on. I just hope that nothing like that ever happens again. We need, as Christians, to stand up and let folks know where we stand as Christians. You don't have to agree with everybody, but you do have to be agreeable when you do disagree, I think. Is there anything else? If not, then Brayden.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We're there for you. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Oh, open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken, and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Aren't you glad you don't have to follow that? Wow. Thank you, Braden. That's wonderful. It's wonderful. And I expect you to sing it again real soon. It's fantastic. God's peace be with you. Thank you. As we go to prayer this morning, I heard that Robert Harrell, little Robert, had an automobile accident, and last time I heard, he was in Charlotte. Is he still? He's back home. Okay. But he did have surgery there, right? And so let's remember him. And then Ann Green, I had the funeral yesterday for her brother. So remember Mary Ann Green and her family in the loss of her brother. Let's pray together. Oh, Father, we've come today to worship you. We have been sustained by you. You are the foundation of our lives. And we praise you and we thank you for an opportunity to come to you in Jesus' name and just lay our hearts before you. You've heard our needs, Father. You've heard the desires of our hearts, because your sweet and Holy Spirit has searched, and you know us, Father. You know everything about us. And Lord, we just praise you. Father, some of us are at home watching our service. Some are in another building and some here, but all of us, Father, are one in Christ, and we thank you for that. And we say, with your word, Father, come quickly, Lord Jesus. We're so very concerned for the world in which we live, a world of illness, both physical and spiritual. And we pray, Father, for the healing of your Spirit on our lives and on our world. But Lord, you're the God of the universe, and so we pray, Father, for the humbleness of spirit to understand that you're so much greater than we can begin to understand. Lord, we just praise you and we thank you for every evidence of your presence in our lives. We thank you for the beauty of this day. We thank you for just the joy of seeing a little snow this week. We just thank you for the birds that sing and just all the ways that you show your greatness. Father, this morning we pray for America. We're saddened, as so many are, by some who have taken the law into their own hands. And just like this summer, it's just one after the other, showing that they do not know you. And so we pray for America. Father, we also pray for those who are putting the word out. We pray for our missionaries. We think of the Moras down in Honduras and all that they've gone through. And we just lift them up to you, Father. We pray for our other missionaries throughout the world. We pray, Lord, that you bless them where they are. Again, we praise you that you hear us and that you know us. And we lift up our prayer in the precious and wonderful name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, good morning. I'm thankful the preacher had to go after Braden. She gets me every single time. I think I have flashbacks from when I first came, and Braden and Cadence were the two in my Mission Friends class. So every time Braden gets up and sings, that's what I see. Well, how many of you have ever seen someone do something with clay, whether it be a potter or maybe you had to do something? I know in high school art class, my art teacher, she loved pottery, and so she would oftentimes make us work with clay. And although I was never really good at it, I obviously gave it 110%. But what she would always tell us is that you have to start with a big just lump of clay. And she would tell us to kind of put it in a ball, and then we would throw it onto the potter's wheel. And then from there, we would have to put some force in it. And when we put force in it, it would kind of spread out. And we would have to put force in it while it was, you know, spinning on the pottery table. And then you could pull up on it to make it into a vase, or push it down to make it into a cup if you didn't want it that tall. But after a while of working with it, it took shape. And then at the very end, whenever we would go to take it off of the pottery wheel, you could look on it, and from where our hands had been touching it, there was our prints. It was our fingerprints. And so it brought me to a verse in Isaiah. It's Isaiah 64:8, and I want to read it for you this morning. And it says, "Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are the potter. We are all works of your hands." It doesn't say that some of us are works. It says we are all works of your hands. And we are just like this clay. God molds us. He makes us into his creation.
And if you look at our lives, we should see his prints on our lives. Not our prints, but our Father God's prints. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you. Thank you for being the potter. Thank you for molding us and shaping us into what you have called us to be. Lord, sometimes we are difficult, and sometimes it takes a little while for you to get us how you want us to be. But thank you for never giving up on us. And Lord, thank you for your love, and thank you for your promise, and thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. We love you and we praise you. Amen.
Living for Jesus, who died in my place, bearing on Calvary my sin and disgrace. Such love constrains me to answer his call. Follow his leading and give him my all. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to thee, for thou in thine atonement didst give thyself for me. I own no other master. My heart shall be your throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for you alone.
Cinderella. Oh, you heard me that time. A new start. 2 Corinthians 5, 14 and 17 is what we're going to read in a little bit. Most of us know this very familiar story. Cinderella, perhaps more well known to the female population, but you know, I don't know about that. I think most of us know the story. It's a sad story with a happy ending of a young girl that loses her mother, and then her father, when he remarries, well, he marries someone who treats Cinderella badly, and then also her two stepsisters treat her badly. There are a number of renditions of this story. I was surprised as I looked into it. It's as old as the time of Christ. It's come into a different, you know, the general, the gist of the story has come into the Chinese world, into the Greek world, into Europe. It was done in Italy, and eventually the Brothers Grimm is the story that most of us know. Most of us are familiar particularly with the Disney version, the animated film in 1950. That's the first time, I guess, I was introduced to the story. And although the story's title and main character's name changes in those different countries and different languages, the lesson is the same. So, why am I standing up here on Sunday morning when it's time for a sermon bringing up a fairy tale? Aren't I supposed to preach the gospel, the good news? Well, I do so to remind you of that good news. So, what is the good news of this poor, neglected girl? Well, in the fairy tale, Cinderella, through magic and through miracle, ends up going to the big dance, the ball at the palace, and on that last night, she wins the heart of the prince and then runs away at midnight, losing her shoe on the palace steps as she goes. And the prince, of course, searches his kingdom. He wants to find this young woman. And Cinderella is back in her usual state, wearing rags and covered with dirt from her slave-like drudgery. But the golden slipper fits, and she becomes the future princess of the land, and I guess the future queen of the land. And so what is the gospel in all this? Well, the gospel, the good news of the kingdom of God, is that Christians all have the right shoe size, okay? That the bride of Christ has been chosen and the church is it. The Prince of Peace, the Prince of Glory, the Prince of Life has chosen the church. And the only question that remains is, does the slipper fit your foot? 2 Corinthians 5:14 to 17, and I have that behind me and before me, and I'm going to turn to that. Paul writes to the church in Corinth, "For the love of Christ controls us, having concluded this, that one died for all, therefore all died. And he died for all so that they who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who died and rose again on their behalf. Therefore, from now on, we recognize no one according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him in this way no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old things passed away. Behold, new things have come." God adds his blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. You see, the foot that fits the Christian shoe has qualities and characteristics found in this passage. Before we get into this passage, I want to go to the end of Corinthians because he sums up things and kind of gives us an idea of why he's written this letter in the first place. And we find a passage in 2 Corinthians 13:5, "Test yourselves to see if you are in the faith. Examine yourselves. Or do you not recognize this about yourselves, that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you fail the test?" Test yourselves. Examine yourselves. Does the shoe fit? Our passage today contains that test, I believe, and I want us to go back to piece by piece on this scripture. And the first part of it is that first part of the first verse, "For the love of Christ controls us." Now, that word controls us in the King James is constraineth, constrains, holds together. But the Greek word really means something on the terms of, well, it does mean hold us from the outside so that we don't fall apart. And I think that's very important in our world today because I can tell you, without Christ, I would be falling apart. You know, when I look at what happened this past week, when I look at what happened this summer, when I look at the COVID thing, when I look at North Korea and China and Russia, and I look at all the situation that the people that we meet on the street, I can tell you that without Christ, the whole world falls apart. The only thing that's holding our world together now is the Holy Spirit of God within the church, within the people of God. He's holding us together. Would you fall to pieces without Jesus? I know I would. So the question is, does the shoe fit? Does the shoe fit? The second part of that scripture, "That one died for all, therefore all died." You know, the whole story of the Christian life is that we have been born again. Isn't that what Jesus said to Nicodemus in John 3? Isn't that the message of the New Testament through the Apostle Paul and through John and Peter? Isn't it over and over again that something has happened within us? Something new has been given to us. We were that old self, that person that lived before we knew Christ. And then God, through His Holy Spirit, came into our lives and we had a new self. You know, we had a baby spirit and we had that old self. And let's think about that. You know, think about it in terms of a garden. If I have a flower and I have a weed right beside it and I water the weed but don't water the flower, you know what's going to happen, right? The weed is eventually probably going to kill that flower. It's going to wrap around it. It's going to kill it. But if we feed the flower, if we water the flower and look out for the flower and leave the weed alone or maybe pull it up, what will happen? Well, we're going to have a beautiful flower. And friend, that's true of us as Christians. So, you know, we receive that new self within us. We receive that new life, that baby spirit within us. And you and I need to make sure that what we're feeding in our lives is that spirit instead of that old self. I remember my old self. I remember my character. I remember my passions. I remember my desires. I don't want that person anymore. And so I haven't given anything to that. I haven't put any energy in that. I've put my energy and my time and my effort, my water and my fertilizer to that new self within me. Are you dead to the old self? And is Christ living in and through you? The question is always, does the shoe fit? You know, I've seen a lot of non-Christ attitudes over the last few COVID months. Even within the life of this church, it seems to be three sides. It seems to be the left and the right and then Christ's side. And the Lord's side put others first. The Lord's side sacrifices for those who are weaker than them. The Lord's side loves and serves and even goes to the cross for those unworthy of His love. And so I'm asking you, church, are you on the Lord's side or do you fail the test? Does the shoe fit? And He died for all so that they who live might no longer live for themselves, but for Him who died and rose again on their behalf. If you wondered why Stephen did a wonderful job singing, living for Jesus, you wonder why I asked him to do that. Look at the words. The words came out of this scripture. Living for Jesus who died in my place, bearing on Calvary my sin and disgrace. Such love constrains me. Do you hear that? This is 2 Corinthians 5:17. Such love constrains me. It holds me together. And it yields out of me an answer to His call. Follow His leading and give Him my all. Oh, Jesus, Lord and Savior. Friend, He's not your Savior unless He's your Lord. And I think we've moved away from that. We've lost sight of that. God is love in the form of a servant. He showed Himself in Jesus to be that. And I think we've lost sight of what it means to be a Christian. I see so many non-Christian attitudes within the life of the church and, of course, outside in the world. He is Lord and Savior. I give myself to Thee, for Thou in Thine atonement didst give Thyself for me. I own no other master. My heart shall be Thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for Thee alone. Well, these lyrics are biblical. And Christians are to be Jesus in the world because Jesus was Bill Fryer on the cross. Jesus died in my place. And so I'm to live in His place with His Spirit and His direction and His holiness. Verse 15, they who live, that's us, might no longer live for themselves, but for him. We're to live for Jesus, live in his place. For he died and rose again on our behalf. You are Jesus in the world, if the shoe fits. You need to answer that question. I think some people have gone through stillbirths. I haven't seen a whole lot of Christ living in people. Verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old things passed away. Behold, new things have come. What part of living for Jesus do you not understand, church? What of his character is fuzzy to you? The character of Christ is well outlined in Galatians 5, the fruit of the Spirit, love, which means being self-sacrificial toward others. Joy, which means facing every difficulty in life with eternal eyes that see past the situation to the joy set before us. Peace means bringing people together. And again, I say this to both sides. Hopefully, bring you back to the middle. We're to be peacemakers. Patience. That means your temper under control. Kindness means tolerant of others. Goodness means being like God. God is the only good one. Faithfulness means keeping on in spite of the circumstances that we face. Gentleness is being humble in spirit. Self-control really means God control. Does the shoe fit, church? Is this who you are? Is this who you're becoming as you are faithful to God, seeking his word, seeking his way in your life? Everything we have and are as Christians is because we are in Christ. Listen, in Christ is not just mentioned here, it's in the scriptures 90 times. In the New Testament, 90 times that we're to be in Christ. Listen to them. Being justified is a gift by his grace through the redemption, which is in Christ. You need to be in Christ to be redeemed. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ. Therefore, there is no condemnation. Where is there no condemnation? For those who are in Christ. And I'm going to do a few more, because we need to get this through our minds. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds. Where? In Christ. We all want to be Cinderella spiritually. We all want to be in heaven. There are a lot of people in the membership of churches throughout the world, churches I've been in, churches my pastor friends talk to me about. They're going through the same thing. That the shoe just doesn't fit. A new creation. In Christ, a new creation. Not better, and not smoothed over. You know the difference between a used car and a new car, don't you? A new creation in Christ. Do you need to get right with the Lord this morning? Let's pray. Oh, Father, thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you that he went all the way to Calvary and suffered and died for my sins and for the sins of all who claim him as Savior and follow him as Lord. Father, help us be very honest with ourselves this morning. Are we stuck in the same place? Are we still a baby? Has the baby died? Where are we with you, Father? Help us to take a step forward and truly live under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. With that true love that you showed us, that sacrificial, you're more important than I am kind of love. Lead us, I pray, in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. I hope that I have some phone calls this afternoon. Blessings.